So we're actually officially launching autonomous receivables. We think of it as order to cash and autopilot. But before I get into the video itself, let me give you a little bit of background so that you can kind of get a context when you're looking at this video, why it was designed in a certain way, just some high-level concepts. So first of all, if you look at the user interface, it looks very different. So there are three things that we have incorporated in this version of the software that we are launching. First is the user interface is very context-sensitive intelligent, which means that it doesn't, each screen will not, kind of look the same in terms of branding, but really the real estate usage is almost like an entire slate, like a mobile-like user interface, where you maximize providing the information that is most relevant at that point of time for the user, right, versus you going and searching information. So that's one concept. There are two other concepts. One of them is touch, and the third concept is voice. So we try to design this software to compete with that. In essence, how do we maximize the usage of touch and voice to compete with the keyboard? In essence, reduce the strain of the users. So the right information and the most relevant information is right in front of them. How they can do a simple touch or a voice instruction to get their job done. So we're going to do a live experience.
Okay, so we have our work board, the 20 calls that come up. I'll be playing Roger, who is a collector with ABC products. We're going to enlist Frida for our guidance. Frida, show me Permalink.
Hi, Roger.
Show me Permalink.
Sure, fetching the details of Permalink.
Here are the variables, the broken promises, and the other items that lead to the risk factors, why that's the first call on the list. Now I'm going to make a call and discuss this with the customer. Frida, call now.
Okay, initiating the call. I will be on standby taking the notes.
Hi, this is Kathy.
Kathy, good afternoon. It's Roger with ABC Products.
Hi, Roger. How can I help you?
I'm calling regarding invoice number 16825. The amount is $3,214. Can you confirm that will be when that will be paid?
Yes. Roger, I can process that payment on Tuesday.
Thanks, Kathy. That would be great. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
So we have our summary, we have our approval, we have our email with the invoice attached. On to the next customer. There it is.
I'm actually going to completely switch gears and go to a completely different subject. I think it's a subject that is a fairly emotional subject, an important subject for us. I think it's the whole debate that is happening in the world as we speak around humans versus machines or humans and machines, right? A lot of articles being published, jobs at risk, AI, machine learning, are they going to replace humans and all that stuff, right? So a lot of stuff out there. It's very easy to forecast the future. Any reason why? Anyone wants to answer why? Nobody can refute it. You can say whatever you want, right? But past to present is history is factual. So hard to refute history because things have actually happened. In the history of time, I don't think we have a single instance where over these hundreds of thousands of years, a machine has done anything to a human. So we believe that humans versus machines is for the movies. Let's think about why it is humans plus machines and not humans and versus machines. So take a simple use case of you as a consumer, your morning coffee. When you wake up today, You press the button, you expect a good quality coffee to be made for you. But if you go back in time, our parents and grandparents, they spend a lot more time making coffee, the fire and the kettle and so forth. So really, you as a consumer have demanded a better machine so that you can free up that time and improve the quality of your personal life. So the bottom line summary is, the humans plus machines is to improve the quality of human life. We are officially in the digital revolution. If you think about the history of time again, from the hunter-gatherer phase to the farmer, and the industrial revolution, industrial worker, we are the knowledge workers of the new digital revolution, or in the middle of it, or whatsoever. So, in the digital world, or in the digital revolution, every industry is up for disruption. Everybody knows the standard use cases of Uber and what it has done to transportation, Airbnb to hospitality, Netflix to entertainment, Amazon, of course, to retail, and Google for home. But I think it is not just about technology anymore. You could be in any industry. Here's an example of a potential disruption. It's not happened yet, but it could happen. If you are a lumber or a wood manufacturer, you cannot think traditionally anymore. Oh, I'm in the old lumber wood manufacturing business. As we speak, the ceramic tiles business is fundamentally potentially disrupting this. Why? Because you can print whatever shade you want on ceramic tiles. You can have whatever texture you want. It is a lot more durable from a maintenance standpoint and costs lesser. So if you walk into a modern retail store like Starbucks today, you might be thinking you're walking on a wood floor, but most likely you're walking on a ceramic tile floor, right? So just because you're in a traditional industry doesn't mean you're not up for disruption. The rules of the game have changed. So given that, this is what is happening in the boardrooms and CFOs of any company out there. Any company, any CXO or that I talk to or a board member, is the same thing. The fear of disruption, in my view, in a very genuine way, not just because you just like to have fear, but genuinely, the CXOs of your companies are waking up every day thinking they might not be relevant in a decade from now if they don't figure out a way to evolve in the digital revolution. The world is changing. So, well, everyone in this room, you might say, okay, all this is great, human versus machines, whatever, boards, companies, CXOs, how do I care? What do I need to do? So I think your role in the digital age is extremely important, and I'm going to walk you through how. So a simplistic view of a company, I know there are lots of levels, but if you think about any company, there are three sets. You have the executive leadership, that is the CXOs, the boards. You have the analysts who are actually doing the work, on the AR analysts, and then the management, which is probably likely the most of you in this room. Now, if you think about your executive leadership, they are driving the digital transformation for core business. So your exec leadership, as we speak, is probably taking some serious calculated bets in their core business, whatever industry you are in. That's their main focus going forward. And they are encouraging transformation of other corporate functions. But honestly, from their standpoint, they don't have time for that. They're going to spend their time on the core business, not on whether it's a corporate finance function, AR function, AP, whatsoever, right? As management, everybody in this room, you have the opportunity to what I call as manage up, where you can proactively lead the digital transformation for your function. It is almost a welcoming thing. It's not that there is pushback anymore. Because if you think about your company, digital transformation is about culture. It's not just that you're going to do one thing. If you're a shoe manufacturer, I'll figure out a way to disrupt shoe manufacturer. If you think about Amazon as an example, it is in their core DNA to disrupt everything that they do, right? So on the other hand, if you take an AR analyst, they're obviously in the mode of humans versus machines and the fear of the unknown. So I think the role here for you as management is, how can you be a true mentor to handhold your AR analyst through the change management. So I think it's a very important role because you might get a pushback, they might have some fear of job loss maybe, or they're not open to change, they would prefer to do it the old way. But as management, how can you handhold them for their own good? How do you communicate to them that selfishly for you, you're better off in transforming yourself slowly and steadily into the digital era? If our entire company can make a big bet, why not you as an individual to not be irrelevant? If an entire $10 billion company is making a big bet to be relevant in a decade from now, can you as an AR analyst, for your own selfish reasons, make some small changes to be relevant from a decade from now? Relatively doesn't seem like, I'm not trivializing the issue, but relatively not as big a problem as a big company that has to shift, right? So I think in summary, your role is you are the digital transformation change agent. As we talked about, your execs have things to do, your AR analysts have their fear. So how do you kind of bridge the gap, be the connections between these two levels to bring the transformation to your company?